Good evening and welcome to the launch of Professor Patrick Minford's new book, Should Britain Leave the European Union? Which has been published by the Institute of Economic Affairs in association with Edward Elgar. I'll say a little bit more about how you can buy the book later in the proceedings. It's my pleasure to introduce Patrick. Patrick is a trustee of the IEA and professor of economics at Cardiff University Business School, previously at Liverpool University. He's been awarded a CBE for his services to economics and was previously one of the wise men who was consulted by Chancellors Norman Lamont and Kenneth Clark on a panel of forecasters who helped inform economic decision making in the wake of the fallout of the ERM crisis. The format is that Patrick is going to talk to us for a few minutes about the ideas in the book, then I'm going to ask him two or three questions, and then I'll throw the questions open to the floor so you can all quiz Patrick, and then we'll have a drink and a few nibbles in the boardroom after the event. So Patrick, perhaps you can tell us what your research says, why you think that Britain would benefit from leaving the European Union, and to what extent you think Britain would benefit from leaving the European Union.
Sure. Thank you very much, Philip, for your kind words, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be here and to be talking about this book, which has been quite a lot of work to produce a second edition. It is the second edition of this book. I first wrote this book in 2005, which is, I think, a bit over 10 years ago. And quite a lot of has happened since then. So it needed updating. And, okay, what does it say? The first point is that this discussion is about self-government. You'd think from some of the debate that it isn't, but actually it is. It's about whether Britain, with 1,000 years of history, which now finds itself in something approximating the Austro-Hungarian Empire, not having thought it was going to get into that, a very centralized, bureaucratic European apparatus run mainly by other people, it finds itself in this, and, you know, it's not really what it intended, the British people. And there's a political economy point here, which is that if you have a democracy where, you know, in the time-honored way of bureaucracy, of democracy, you can throw the people out when they don't please you, the government, and get them to change and get another government in, this process in political economy breeds learning and change. And we've had lots of changes in the UK, lots of reforms, and they've been the result of the democratic process. Now, if you contrast that with the political economy of the EU, it's very difficult to get those guys out. It doesn't matter what mistakes they make, what they do to you, you can't actually budge them. And that is the fundamental problem. We're in a political economy setup where the policies are decided by mainly other people, and it has no reverse gear. And so that's the basic point, the political economy point. And then, you know, what is Brexit? Well, I think Brexit is a rather dramatic name for what I call Breset. I think that, you know, it's possible for adults to get in a room and have relationships with each other. This would be a bilateral treaty between ourselves and the EU where we identify mutual interests and pursue them in an adult manner, in foreign policy, you know, terrorist measures and all that sort of thing, as well as loads of areas of economics. And that would be a desirable treaty for both sides to replace what is, I think, a treaty that's got completely out of hand from our point of view. Now, the third point is, what is the group of people who are in favour of staying in the EU saying? They're basically saying two things. They're saying the EU won't change very much from where it is. You know, the status quo is what we've got, and that's what we'll have if we stay in the EU, sort of cling on to Nurse, because Nurse is always going to be the same reassuring figure. And they say, well, we can cope with Nurse as she is, and she's quite a reassuring figure. And the other thing they're saying is that if we leave, there'll be huge economic costs. Now, the first point about both these points are dealt with in the book. The first point about that is the EU going to maintain the status quo is manifestly false. I mean, the EU is on a big journey. It's the start of a big journey towards ever closer union. Let's not talk about too much about those words. But what they're planning to do is to create all sorts of unions to deal with the crises in the Eurozone and other crises that they face. And they are bent on a lot of integration. So it's going to be a big journey that the EU's embarking on, and it's not going to be the status quo. The second point is this, about the economic costs if we leave. This is where the research that I've been doing for quite a few years now says the exact opposite. I mean, the truth is that there's a vast set of costs that are involved in being in the EU. Now, I'm going to ask for a table. There's one table in my book which is really got it all in, the costs, the net costs of being in the EU. It's the exact opposite of what the pro-EU lobby say about, you know, you want to worry about leaving the EU because it'll be so economically costly. The first point, I think, well, everybody knows about the net UK contribution. I won't say any more about that. What about trade? Trade is supposed to be the big thing that we ought to stay in the EU to be in the trading relationships that the EU has with us and with everybody else. That's supposed to be a big plus. But of course, it ignores the fact, as my mentor at LSE always used to stress, Professor Harry Johnson, that the EU is a customs union, highly protectionist. We've done a lot of sums on this in the book, and basically, it's not just agriculture, it's the whole manufacturing sector is heavily protected in the EU by the customs union tariff and tariff equivalent wall. All sorts of non-tariff measures through anti-dumping duties, through threats of anti-dumping duties, through quotas. And you can cost them by looking at the prices that result inside the EU as a result of this protected wall, protectionist wall. And when you do the sort of standard free trade simulation of what it would be if you got rid of this protection and moved the UK to free trade, you know, out into the world market at world prices, the results are what you'd expect. Prices fall in the UK, and the economy restructures towards the areas where we have a comparative advantage, and that's worth about 4% of GDP to us. Some of that gain is from the fact that we buy a lot from the EU at these protected prices, which are above world prices, and we sell much less to them at these protected prices. And so we have a net balance of disadvantage inside the customs union in terms of the composition of our exports and imports. That's all in that 4%. So very opposite of what people say, how wonderful it would be, how dangerous it would be to leave, we make a huge gain by leaving, by getting back to world prices. World trade. And the other point that is often said is that it'll be very cold out there because we'll find it very hard to negotiate any trade agreements. But this is a very misleading argument, because when you do a trade agreement with other countries under free trade, the question you've got to ask is, will that trade agreement affect the world prices at which you sell? And these trade agreements with all sorts of little countries or even medium-sized countries will have no effect on world prices, because all that will happen will be that we'll get an advantage in those markets, sell a bit more in those markets, but that change won't affect the prices for the products we sell in world markets. The world prices, which are created in a massive world market, they'll be too small to affect that. As a result, the world prices won't change. We'll produce the same. And all we'll do with these trade agreements, which are talked about so much, is simply divert some output to the country we do a trade agreement with away from the other countries. And our trade partners will sell less in that market and more in the others. It's simply a trade diversion operation. It has no welfare effect. Now, let me just briefly say a few more things on these economic issues. Regulations. Well, we all know about regulation. and the way in which the European Union tries to regulate an awful lot of stuff on the grounds that everything has to be regulated to make a level playing field. Well, this is absolute nonsense in terms of economic efficiency. What you need is competing appropriate regulations in different markets so that people can compete. This obsession with regulation of things like social conditions, all sorts of labor market situations, powers of unions, all this sort of thing, as well as lobbying in product markets, has led to a very big burden in regulation, which is identified by OECD measures. And it has also led to labour market inefficiencies in the UK, which we've kind of got out of in various ways through things like zero-hours contracts. But as we know, there's a lot of intervention here. Now, costing this is quite difficult, but we know that at the macro level, at the level of the economy, this affects your competitiveness. And if this goes very far, it can affect your competitiveness a lot, which is why there's a very big range on this measure, from 6%, which is roughly where we are now, we reckon, to a potential 25% if some of the more lunatic proposals in regulation come in. Another thing that people talk about, which I'll say in parentheses here, is that if we left the EU, we'd lose foreign direct investment and we'd lose jobs. Now, this is just a classic economic fallacy at the macro level. Any first-year student of macroeconomics knows that when the structure of an economy changes, jobs are lost in one sector and gained in others. That's exactly what would happen here. Of course, there'll be a contraction in the protected sectors that no longer get the protection when we leave, but other sectors would expand, creating jobs, taking up the slack, and of course, on balance, there'll be more jobs because the economy will be more productive. So that's the jobs argument. FDI, foreign direct investment, we're told that so many people invested here to get behind the EU's tariff war. It's true. Of course, FDI is attractive in a protected sector because it has high profits to get lots of investment in cars. Of course, there won't be investment in those protected sectors after we leave, but there'll be other sectors that'll be expanding, making more profits, and the FDI, which is just a simply routine kind of factor provision from foreigners, will go into the other sectors. As the economy changes shape, so will the direction of FDI. So there's no evidence there of any problem. It's simply a perfectly natural, well, it's not a natural fallacy, but it's definitely a fallacy. And let me then just finish off with a few kind of sweeping up remarks. It's said that we've got the opt-out from the euro. But as I read the statement today, you know, that's been given to Mr. Cameron by Mr. Tusk, President Tusk, it says, you better be careful about the euro because the euro is where we're all going. The eurozone is the union that the EU is destined for, and everybody in principle who joins the EU has to join it. Now, you've got an opt-out, but don't undermine the eurozone. I think the logic of our position outside the eurozone is very tenuous, looking 10, 20 years ahead, because there's always going to be conflict and pressures on us to surrender that opt-out. And we saw how Tony Blair surrendered on day one the opt-out from the social chapter when he came in, and he told industry, don't worry, I'll veto anything I don't like. Well, what a lot of nonsense. I mean, he couldn't veto anything, of course. Once he'd surrendered the opt-out, and the social chapter rolled in here. Same will be true, I think. There'll be pressure on us to surrender the opt-out from the euro. And if we do, God help us. Because if we'd been in this crisis inside the euro, we'd have been like Greece. Perhaps not quite as bad. But you know, we had a very bad banking crisis here, for which we needed all the scope we got from monetary policy and fiscal policy to kind of get us afloat again. And we would have had very little slack cut for us within the euro. So apart from the general problem of the bailouts that we become liable to once we're in the euro, we also have this problem, which is noted here, of the doubling of volatility that would occur if you lose control of your currency. Migration is supposed to be something that, you know, all good economists are in favor of immigration. I think this country's got a strong, proud record on immigration. I think the problem is that if you've what you would like as a country in immigration, any sane immigration policy will prioritize particular groups of immigrants within some sort of framework of quantities of immigrants that will maintain social order. That's just common sense in any country. And what I think many British citizens object to is the way in which we've got no control over half of the immigration world we're dealing with. No control at all. And therefore, any prioritization we might want to make is completely overruled by, of course, the free movement from one group of neighbors who really don't have, I don't think, any legitimate right to be prioritized over countries of the Commonwealth, for example, or countries from all over, all other countries where we might want to recruit, you know, skilled people who can contribute to our economy. And so I think that really the migration argument is a very strong one from a politico-economic viewpoint. Any rational migration system has to be kind of fair to all parties, and the one we've got is clearly, I think, in my view and in the view of many other people, manifestly unfair, because it's unfair to those that have to be tightened up to make room for the completely uncontrolled migration from unskilled workers, any workers who want to come here, that we permit to the EU. So let me finish and say, what we have here is a democratic requirement, really, on the part of British citizens for democracy, for the restoration of self-government. And, you know, with all the benefits that that brings in the form of economic policy and other policies. And yet, what we have is an extraordinary phenomenon. We have a lot of our establishment arguing against it on the grounds of trying to bamboozle the British people with all sorts of spurious arguments. You know, the reverse of the truth, that somehow economically we'd be damaged if we leave, it's manifest nonsense. Economically, logically, we're hugely benefited by leaving a protectionist, you know, area with over-regulated, damaging to growth, damaging to efficiency, damaging to the shape of the economy. And so here we have our establishment, you know, even the Conservative Party, you know, the establishment, the elite, telling us that we shouldn't exercise our rights of self-government because somehow we can't govern ourselves. We've got to be governed by this kind of weird Austro-Hungarian, modern kind of redivivus Austro-Hungarian empire. It's most extraordinary. And the arguments being advanced for it are so manifestly wrong that it takes my breath away. And therefore, I feel justified in writing this book.
Thank you, Patrick. Perhaps I could just start by really referring to the beginning and end of your remarks. Of political economy you outlined at the beginning, and then you talked about democracy at the end. The political economy that the IEA brought to the UK in the 60s, 70s and 80s of Buchanan, Tulloch and so on, also talked about the importance of constraints on democracy, that democracies don't automatically deliver the sort of perfect liberal world that you and I might like. Do you not think that in any respect the European Union has constrained governments both in continental Europe and also in the UK from doing things which are harmful and illiberal? Migration might be one example. To give another example, Anna Soubry, the industry minister, was on Newsnight a couple of weeks ago saying that she had managed to get the most protectionist settlement out of the European Union possible, most protectionist settlement ever, in fact, for the UK steel industry, and that this was a great victory, that she was able to protect the UK steel industry to a greater extent than the European Union had previously ever allowed. Other areas, perhaps the deregulation of airlines and so on. Don't you think there have been any areas where the EU's constraints on governments have actually led to greater liberalism and better economic welfare?
Well, it's a good question. And I think the problem is that the EU has been manifestly an anti-free market organization in net terms. I mean, this is where we get these costs from. First of all, it's highly protectionist. Secondly, it's massively over-regulative. You know, I mean, something like 10% of our GDP is devoted to exports to the EU, even now, after this long period of being in the EU, and yet 90% of the rest of the economy is regulated by the EU in all sorts of ways that are damaging. And I would characterize the EU's policies as what I would call socialish. What I mean by socialish, as opposed to socialist, a socialist wants to own the means of production and use them to create social, you know, welfare as he or she sees it. A socialist person doesn't want to use the means of production because it's much too hard to do that. Still, issue a lot of directives that will achieve covertly the same results by regulation. And that, I think, is the spirit, unfortunately, of the EU. And it's, I think the point is illustrated by Mrs. Thatcher's own approach to the EU, because as you will recall, in the 1980s, she was very keen on the single market and helped Monsieur Delors to bring in the single market. But then after she'd helped him do that, Monsieur Delors said, ah ha ha, I fool you. Now we're going to have the social market. And he kind of negated the whole thing by bringing in this huge social regulative initiative. And so I think that this is the problem, that effectively what the EU is indeed a supranational body with huge powers, but it uses it in ways that aren't in the interests of liberty and free markets, but it uses it in the interests of what it sees as social welfarism and control. And this is a big worry, I think.
Secondly, I'd like to ask about the counterfactual. The counterfactual appears to be a comparison of the European Union as it is and as it might evolve with the UK as you'd like it to be. Now, those of us who are paid employees at the IEA spend our time tearing our hair out at George Osborne's and the DUP's latest announcement. So we're about to have a living wage or minimum wage for those over 25 of knocking on for 60% of median earnings. In 2017, employers will have to pay 3% into people's pensions. We've got the 0.5% training levy, a whole raft of stuff on paternity leave and all the rest of it. None of these things have been influenced by the EU in any way at all. And I'm just wondering to what extent you think the things that are wrong with the UK economy are the EU's fault, as opposed to the fault of this democracy, which ought to be leading us towards the liberal change that you would like.
Yes, I think that's a good point too. I mean, Adam Smith, in a letter to a young man who was sort of saying to him, but look how terrible the UK is, you know, Mr. Professor Smith, you know, you have this wonderful free market vision for the UK, but actually, let me tell you, it's not like that. And Adam Smith wrote back and said, there's a lot of ruin in a nation. It was a great remark. And yes, it's true. I benchmarked all these calculations against a free market Britain. And clearly Britain is not free market, totally. By any means, all the things you've said. In fact, one of our mutual friends pointed out that our assumption about that the EU might bring in very large minimum wages has been actually trumped by Mr. Osborne quite effectively. And all this is very true. And so clearly the UK makes mistakes, and this is clearly one of them. And so it's not going to be totally free market. But there's a lot of ruin in the numbers. You know, if you're making gains compared with a counterfactual of something like 50% of GDP, it seems to add up to by the time you kind of look a couple of decades ahead. You've got a lot to play with in the way of ruin. And I think the other point is the political economy point. Just as the EU is not an ideal free market, liberty-related American constitution, you know, that Tulloch would have liked, Buchanan, so the UK is a learning democracy. That's what I like about it. You know, I've lived through a lot of UK history, and what it's given me is huge respect for the judgment of my fellow citizens.
They've made terrible mistakes. In fact, they're like Osborne's national living wage. It's frightening. But the truth is, they've done a lot of things that were good, and they've learned from mistakes. You know, think about the mistakes of the 70s, the reforms of the 80s, the willingness to go with some pretty hard medicine. I think that we'll learn about the... I don't know if the national living wage will come in. I mean, it seems to be such an absurd idea. And the low pay commission was set up to kind of stop this sort of nonsense. So there's a lot of water still to flow under the bridge, I think. But the main point I'd make is that if you've got a learning democracy, you've got a powerful mechanism there for making mistakes, but then remedying them. And my worry about the alternative is that there's no mechanism there for remedying the mistakes. You know, there's a cultural sort of socialishness, which I've described, very much not the Buchanan Talib thing, and there's no reverse gear. There's no mechanism for recognizing a mistake. I mean, even now, after the absolute tragedy that's been caused by the euro, nobody anywhere on the continent will admit there's anything wrong with it. What they're going to do is make it bigger and better, and more unionized, and more this, and more that, and more councils, and more... Yeah, and so it goes on. It's extraordinary. So these guys, they never say, you were right to tell us it was wrong. They said, oh no, it's fine. You know, we just had a little bit of a problem. A little local difficulty.
Well, the living wage comes in on April Fool's Day. I suspect it will still be there on April the 2nd, I'm afraid. And finally, I just wondered, we get a lot of visitors, particularly young visitors to the IEA, interns and so on, from Central and Eastern Europe. I just wonder how you think of the issue from... their point of view. Now, if you were a Slovak or a Slovene, would you be inclined to favour the European Union, and would you be rather worried about the UK leaving, from the point of view of economic liberty, of course?
Yes, I think you would. But really, I have to say that it's not our job to help everybody else by punishing ourselves. Now, we need to get out of this thing, get stronger, and help from the outside to... by competition with the European Union and by showing how things can be run, to show them that, you know, competing with these guys, that this is the way to run a railroad, not the way they're trying to do it, by constant centralization, collective, you know, these centralized measures the whole time. And of course, I think that in our outer capacity, we'll have, as I said, a brief set. There will be good relations, I hope, I believe, because once, as it were, all the sort of shouting is over, I think people will come into the room and they will negotiate a new relationship that will, as I say, be mutually, for the mutual interests of the two parties. And that includes a reasonable immigration policy, which I think, you know, we will admit a lot of people from Slovakia and Czech Republic. And we need these guys, you know. But it's got to be under some sort of control, some sort of political and economic control.
Okay. So let's open it up to the floor. Sorry, is there a microphone going around? Look, there is. Yeah, gentleman at the second row on the left. Could you just wait for the microphone?
If we negotiate to come out, do you feel we will get back, as of right, things like our fishing policy, or have we given that away forever?
Fishing policy. Well, of course, yes, we would in fact get that back.
Would we?
Oh, yes. Well, I mean, we might give it away again, but it's something we can negotiate about. Obviously, I have no idea what negotiators in the end will do when we come to Brie set. And indeed, our fishing industry is now so depleted that it may well be a case of, you know, it's all over. But in principle, of course, we regain our own sea limits. Hmm.
Okay, gentlemen, right to the front.
Thank you. My personal view is I think we should leave the European Union. However, a lot of the British public are, I think, risk averse. And my real concern is that they are frightened of change. And what we could have is a situation where they vote to remain. Now, have people like yourself actually got a plan B, that if we did remain, that we could be as Eurosceptic as possible, like actually dealing? Because I think the main issue that you alluded to was the issue of self-government. and actually being able to track these regulations. I just wanted to hear your views on that.
Well, I'm afraid that if we stay in, we're bound hand and foot as we are now. I don't think it's going to be any different. And the point is, it's going to get worse because, as many people have pointed out, and as I mentioned earlier, the train is about to leave the station towards ever closer union and huge amounts of architecture, as it's called, for the Eurozone's survival. And this means that actually there's huge uncertainty for the British people in both options, if you like. I mean, obviously there's uncertainty in leaving because we're not there, we're inside. And so we've got to explain what it'd be like, and they may not, I've explained what I think it'll be like, but they may not believe me. And so obviously they've got to think about that uncertainty, but they've also got to think about the uncertainty of what happens if we stay inside this organization over which we have no control, ultimately at all. Because we're outvoted by qualified majority voting on potentially on every issue. And even with the 55% majority that's been mentioned in the so-called the Tusk proposals today, again, there's no guarantee we'd ever get 55% mustered for that. So the point really is that there's actually a huge unknown staying in. It's not about Klingon to nurse, because the status quo is not anymore an option. It might have seemed to have been 15 years ago, but it's not today. It's quite clear from the Five Presidents report, for example, that massive change is envisaged in the EU. And our position in that is extremely uncertain.
Yeah, gentleman on the inside, about halfway down.
Yeah.
Good evening. If we do come out of the European Union, which I hope we do, isn't it possible that the bureaucrats, crazed man, will try to make us suffer as much as possible? Because when Britain does leave and it's successful and its economy is growing well, we've got new trade deals and all the rest of it, what do you think? Hold on. If we make Britain suffer, it will make other countries not want to leave. I mean, do you think there's any issue of maybe the bureaucrats doing that to us, making us suffer, just cut their nose by their face, as it were?
I don't think so, because they sell a lot to the UK, and this is the whole point of this customs union. The customs union, in terms of transfers of purchasing power for excessively priced goods, has benefited the countries of the rest of the EU considerably, because they're selling to a rich market at these prices. And so I would think the first thing that they would want to do is to negotiate some sort of trade agreement with the EU that allowed them still to have access to this market. And of course to allow us access to the EU market. Now the problem with that from the point of view of my calculations is it worsens our welfare. However, in terms of the kind of transitional costs of leaving, it will be a good way of, for a decade or so, of smoothing out the transition. So what I anticipate is that there will be long negotiations, of course, for 2 years as mandated under Article 50, and then there will be a long transitional period where a lot of our existing relationships will be preserved for say, 5 or even maybe 10 years, things like the car industry frameworks. And this will be something that they will be very anxious to achieve, because if they don't, then a whole bunch of industries on the continent are imperiled.
By the way, if anybody in the other room, I believe you can hear me but I can't see you, wishes to ask a question, just come to the double doors at the back of this room. Gentleman with the microphone.
I wondered what effect us leaving might have on the states of Gibraltar.
Well, the state of Gibraltar is I believe, a colony, isn't it, of the UK?
Yeah.
So it'll still be a colony with us outside. But it will have its usual trading arrangements. There will be some.
people come to Gibraltar. The biggest problem is with Spain, of course, the relationship with Spain. I imagine it will still be a problem, but it will carry on much as we do now, I would imagine.
I mean, actually, when Spain joined, I think that meant that there were two out of the other 11 members that actually had territorial claims on parts of the United Kingdom.
Right.
Obviously, the other one being the Republic of Ireland.
Yes.
Yeah, gentlemen, right at the back.
Given the crisis in the EU at the moment, and the fact that it seems to have an ever-decreasing percentage of world trade, do you think that it will just disintegrate eventually?
Well, this is... ever since the Eurozone crisis started, I've been arguing with my friend, my fellow economists in the UK, that the euro would not disintegrate because there's so much political capital tied up in it. And therefore, I'm not a believer in the disintegration of anything in the EU, simply because, politically, this is a given among the people who govern the EU that what they've done is right and in the interests of this ever closer union. So I think we have to understand that everything that's been done in the EU is done with deadly seriousness. I don't believe there's ever going to be such a thing as a collapse of these structures, because they've been put together with the view to get closer and closer. And we've always underestimated this in this country. And economists have said the euro would collapse, but I think they left out the political factor that, for political reasons, the people who might have left the euro weren't willing to leave it. And for political reasons, the country that might have expelled them, Germany, wasn't willing to do that. And so we come up against these sorts of arguments the whole time. And therefore, I'm not a believer in any of these disintegration hypotheses, which are bandied around, you know, recently. Mr. Manuel Valls apparently conjured up some vision of disintegration. It's complete hypocrisy on his... I mean, you know, it's not sincere. It's really just troublemaking. Doesn't mean it won't happen.
What about demographic collapse? I mean, in 500 years' time, there'll only be 16 Italians alive at current birth rates. But even sort of collapsing things to a shorter time scale, in 50 years' time, there'll be several EU countries, probably 9 or 10, which will lose 40 to 60% of their populations.
Yes, well, I mean, I think Germany's understood this and has welcomed lots of immigrants.
Mm-hmm.
I imagine the same will be true throughout the European mainland. I mean, it's just common sense. When you're facing this sort of demographic crisis, you need a lot of young people, and you will get them from wherever you can find them. And a lot of the ones, of course, immigrating into Germany are actually quite skilled and you know, have good qualifications and so forth. So I think that will be what they will have to do, and I'm not sure they'll do it. Well, we've already seen it happening. Mm-hmm. It'll happen in spades, I think.
Okay, yeah, lady on the third row. Just wait for the back.
We're constantly told that the European Union, because of the size of the market, is able to negotiate very good trade deals on our behalf because of its clout. And how difficult would it be for Britain, on its own, to negotiate good trade deals? And a sort of adjunct point, would it not be that the cost of food would be a lot cheaper for us? And why is nobody, the Out campaign, making that point?
Well, I've made the point. Thank you very much. It is perfectly true. Our consumer prices on day one of this thing happening would drop 8% according to our calculations. So pretty big bonus for the consumer. Of course, food being part of it. As far as these trade deals are concerned, I think we've got to remember that the EU is a package deal. And what we've evaluated is the whole package deal of going to world prices away from EU prices. Some of these trade agreements are simply generalizing EU prices to other markets. We're better off with world prices. This is what our calculations show. Because what these protected prices that the EU imposes on us by membership and generalizes with its other agreements are prices above world prices. They're protectionist prices. And it's kind of like economics 101 kind of point, that free trade gains you know, significant welfare gains by going to world prices because your industries aren't distorted by this. When it comes to then asking, having left the EU and this great bunch of agreements, right, which are part of the deal, would we be disadvantaged in terms of negotiating new trade agreements? My point, which I kind of mentioned earlier but didn't have time to dwell on, so I'm grateful for your question, is that they don't gain us anything. They simply cause diversion of our output to the preferential market. Because these preferential agreements, where we just sign them with various countries, you know, even quite big countries, they're too small in terms of their impacts to affect world prices. If they don't affect world prices, which we're selling to, you see what I mean, then they're not going to affect the size of our industries. So it ineluctably follows that if we're not producing anymore, because the prices are the same, we'll sell more to one bunch of people and less to the other bunch of people, you see. So all we'll do is divert trade. And, you know, you can talk about maybe there's some other trade agreements with big continents that we could negotiate. I would say beware of Greeks bringing gifts in the respect of trade agreements, because, you know, you get a big Greek bearing a big gift, saying, I'll take loads and loads of your stuff. Look for the fine print, what they're going to ask for in exchange, you know. The trade agreements that we're likely to be able to sign will be with smaller players that will just give us some preference. We give them free trade. Now, in my kind of explanation of what we're going to do, we give them free trade anyway. Then the question is, do they want to have tariffs on us? Well, really, we don't care. We don't care because they won't affect the world price, which is what we sell at. What I keep on saying is that our main job as a small global trading nation is to produce good products that people falling over themselves to buy because they like them. And then, you know, we'll sell them at world prices, you know, the going rate in world markets with maybe a little bit of a quality premium. And that'll be, you know, us done. And we'll be much better off.
If anybody wants to sort of defend the EU or really challenge Patrick, wave your hand vigorously. Okay, there's a couple at the back. But before the two gentlemen at the back, the gentleman who has the microphone now.
What do you make of the argument that if Britain leaves the European Union, then Scotland would leave the United Kingdom?
I don't make much of it. I'll tell you why. We give Scotland a large subsidy for the Barnett formula. And if Scotland left the UK, particularly now the oil is completely out of the equation, it would have a deficit on day one of something between 12 and 15% of GDP, which basically involves it in finding a new income tax system. That's more or less what income tax raises, you know? So the Scots are rightly described as canny, I believe. And no canny person would opt to have to invent a new income tax system, I think. And so, you know, I think there's going to be... I think you already hear from the leaders of the SNP that they're not that keen on leaving, really. They don't want another referendum. And I don't think, for all the rattling of the china in the cupboard, they will actually, you know, do anything about it, because the arithmetic will be just the same.
Actually, I'm rather keener on Scotland leaving the UK than I am on the UK leaving the EU, for which read Federal Britain, the IA publication of last year. Gentlemen, right at the back.
Hello, thanks, Professor, for your passionate defence of Brexit. I would like to give you a very, very short German auto-liberal defence of the European Union. You talk quite a bit about regulations. What would you make of market-making regulations? For example, European state aid rules, they've been cracking down on industrial policies all over Europe, making Europe a freer economic entity. Second of all, you mentioned that Britain could make up its own regulations after having left the European Union. I don't quite see that. Norway, Switzerland, all other economies who are not part of the European Union need to accept European law in order to be able to deal with European law. So if you want to actually engage in, I don't know, economic activity with the European Union, a market of 440 million people after Britain has left, you would certainly need to accept their rules in order to trade with them. So what would you make out of these two points, market making regulations and rule externalization by the European Union? And not to forget, Britain has been one of the ardent adopters of EU law. How come?
Yes. Well, I just wish that, you know, the European Union was an ordo-liberal group, because ordo-liberalism is in favor of freedom and free markets, and it doesn't, it's not in favor of excessive regulation or regulation of things that don't need regulating. It's about creating a liberal order that supports free markets and free, you know, free trade. I wish the European Union was like that. It kind of goes back to Philip's question at the beginning. You know, if we had a kind of supranational order that was just like Buchanan and Tulloch and the order liberals would like, it might be a very attractive organization. The problem is we have to deal with things as we find them. And I would love to find it in my mind that I thought the EU was order liberal, because like Mrs. Thatcher in the 1980s, I'd have a very different attitude to it. I think we all would. The problem is it isn't. And that is the reality we have to grapple with. That for it may well be that, you know, Germany would, you know, the order liberals in Germany would support such a Europe, but that's not the one we've got. I wish it was. I wish it was. And then it would be a different argument. Well, the problem is, it's a very political structure, a ramshackle kind of structure with a lot of governments in there with very clear social-ish prejudices which support then a social-ish agenda at the European Union level. Turning to your second point about, you know, we would have to be like Switzerland and Norway and so on and adopt all the regulations. Of course, this isn't true. This is a choice. I mean, if you want to be integrated into the single market, as we are now, then you have to adopt all the regulations. Of course, that's true. And both Norway and Switzerland, through their various treaties, have tried to do that, and that's why they've got all these regulations. My concepts are very different. The concept set out in this book is that we go to free trade. We then trade arm's length with the European Union and adopt simply the regulations. Our exporters adopt the regulations necessary for entering the European market. And that, of course, is 10% of our GDP, as I mentioned, around a tenth. And so this is the point. We would not adopt all these other regulations. You know, we would decide what were the best regulations from the point of view of the 90% of the economy that's not, you know, trading with the EU. And that seems to me to be a logical thing to do. I'm not making it in any hostile spirit. I'm not saying we'd abolish all the regulations that the EU has brought in. We'd probably abolish a few of them, particularly in the labour market. And maybe some of the industrial ones, you know, that have favoured big players. You know, we've heard Dyson, you know, argue that the Hoover industry has been dominated by German big business Hoover makers lobbying the European Union, and he's not very happy about that. As an example, we might change some of those, that detail, you know, in there may be a lot of details that we would change.
Okay, two more questions. A gentleman at the back who has a microphone, and the gentleman right at the front.
So I'd like to point out prior to my question that I am actually in favour of leaving the EU, but I do think the argument you've presented us with is rather a false one. And the main reason is I think it's politically, you know, it's not politically reasonable for the things that you outline to happen. I don't think we're going to get rid of agricultural protection if we leave the EU. We have the National Union of Farmers who would lobby vigorously for a very similar system. We're not going to adopt unilateral free trade. There is no political party proposing that. There is no developed economy in the entire world which has unilateral free trade or no tariff barriers at all. Secondly, if we go back to the table you presented us with previously, if you add up the higher range of estimates you presented there, you get to something like 40% of GDP in terms of the costs of the EU, which seems an intuitively ludicrous figure for costs, because it would take us to something like £6 to £7 billion, in excess of the entire tax take, in terms of costs to our economy. There is no way we would be able to add 40% to our economy, or would have been able to add 40% to our economy going back 40 years. So I'd like you to delve further into those figures, because they seem ludicrous to me.
Well, you see, the thing is that this is a counterfactual, so you can't observe the counterfactual. And let's take those things up one by one. I mean, first of all, agricultural protection. No, I don't think we would have agricultural protection. We used to have something in this country called deficiency payments, which were not agricultural protection, but were support for specific groups of farmers. You know, we put in place to help for other social reasons, like you might have deficiency payments for hill farmers, but they weren't agricultural protection. They were exchequer payments, which is very different and doesn't distort production. It simply maintains a transfer. That's agricultural production. I think we go back to that system. As for free trade, well, you know, a lot of people said in the 70s that the British people would never put up with, you know, union laws or, you know, deregulation of industries such as lawyers. There were numerous examples put forward as to how it was quite politically impossible to deregulate the British economy and to bring in free markets, as happened in the 80s and massive in lots and lots of different ways. And then, you know, you come to free trade. Well, what is the gain from putting tariffs on things? You know, where's the beef here? You know, you're saying to a bunch of industries that are protected, you know, you've got to get yourselves into shape, like just as we did with the steel industry and the coal industry and the nationalized industries in the 80s. There's no real category difference here. Why would the British people not support disciplines of world markets on their industries when the gain for them is consumer prices equal to world prices? A big consumer gain, you know? It makes no sense.
Wait a minute, let me, and then now
you're going to make me forget your third question. Free trade, what was the last one? I can't remember. Anyway, that'll have to do for now.
Yeah.
I had my train of thought, but I can't remember what the third one was. But anyway, agricultural protection, free trade. Oh, yes, the cost. Sorry, yes, the cost.
Implausibly large.
Implausibly large. Mm. Well, you've got to remember that the upper end is my speculation on what would happen if the EU went crazy. Right? That's what it is. The 25% on regulation is if they introduced the whole of the social charter, you know, in one big swoop on a reluctant British state, and all the working hours directives, you know, were tightened up. So I agree with you. It is pretty awful. And it also includes bailouts on a massive scale. So at the upper end of the sort of doomsday crazy scenario, which I think you're right, is crazy, is the EU goes crazy, right? Now, of course, it's unlikely. One hopes it's unlikely that the EU would ever go totally crazy. But I looked at the pensions, you know, the pension systems on the continent, and they're just actuarially frightening. Particularly in view of the demographics that Philip talked about, you know. They're pay-as-you-go pensions with nothing behind them. And even if there's not another euro crisis, which we'd have been, you know, in hock for on a massive amount had we been in the euro, because we'd have been one of the ones that have been paying, you know, there's still, besides the bailouts inside the euro system, there's all the bailouts consistent with the idea of ever closer union with tax sharing. Now that really frightens me. If we had common European taxes, which are the logic of this situation, as we go through to 2030 or something, you know, and people say, oh, well, let's have a common tax system, because after all, haven't we got a union? You know, we should have burden sharing and pooling. And then we find ourselves paying a lot for, you know, unviable pensions on the continent, where the average, you know, the age of retirement is still in the low 60s, if even it's got to there. And this is the nightmare scenario. So I agree with you, my top level costs are awful and crazy, but they're associated with an uncertainty, an end of the spectrum of uncertainty, which includes, unfortunately, you know, a bunch of things which are feasible if crazy. Yeah.
Okay. One very, very brief final question, and hopefully a very, very brief final answer, Patrick.
I shall keep it as brief as I can. Picking up on your earlier point that the decision for Britain to remain in the EU would not be a choice for the status quo, but actually a choice for ever-increasing political union in the EU, what is the counterfactual narrative of what life for the everyday man or woman on the street looks like in that scenario? Not the crazy scenario you just described, but what do taxes look like? What does the quality selection and price of goods and services look like? What does the property market look like? What does the labor market look like? Things like that.
Can you deal with that in 45 seconds?
I don't think it's possible to do more than say, well, what we've done is cost the status quo, protectionism and so on and so forth. And then, really, it was useful, that previous question, because the upper end is kind of if it really went crazy, you know, where it could go. The problem is we've got no control over it.
And we're really at the mercy of a totally alien philosophy here. That's the thing that always frightens me. Because I have lots of friends on the continent, economists, of course, mainly, whether they're really human beings is debatable, of course. But economists, you know, are most unpopular species. But these guys always kind of take deadly seriously all this philosophy. And when I talk to them, I realize that it's just like talking to someone with a completely different mindset. There's no sharing here. They see this as something that's going to happen, and it could lead to a very different state from the one that we've always opted for as a freedom-loving democracy. That's really it. I mean, I can cost the status quo. I can put in the frighteners, which I did. I can put in the growth effects, which make them even more frightening. And then we could, if we're still in this at the end of this year, we just go pray.
Yeah. Okay, thank you, Patrick. 4 points just to finish off. Firstly, I should say that the IEA is an educational charity. The IEA is an institution that doesn't take a view on whether Britain should leave the European Union or not. We have some authors and trustee, Patrick the trustee as well, who have very strong opinions. The staff are somewhat divided, not evenly, but the staff are somewhat divided about the issue. And our job really is to promote education in the field of free market economics. Secondly, please do join us for a glass of wine. I don't think it's EU wine, so we've had to pay both the, to be even handed about it, we've had to pay both the EU customs duties and the UK extortionate excise duties on the product. Thirdly, please do form an orderly queue to buy Patrick's book, which is available for £15. I think the normal retail price is £25, so it's discounted at to £15 tonight, or those of you who've only brought euros, €25 will do. And finally, I'd like to thank Patrick for his excellent opening presentation and for participating in what I think has been a very illuminating Q&A and discussion. Thank you, Patrick.